What is Bitcoin? A cryptocurrency, a new form of monetary system, an easy way to send money across the world. Why should people use it? Well, it's a choice, it's a voluntary thing. If they want to use it, then they will discover a great world of advantages. And I would say that one of the biggest things about Bitcoin is essentially the too big to fail drama that we've lived through and that we're still living through. I don't know if any of you have heard today the news out of Austria, where some bank bondholders were bailed in. So the bailout is turning into bail-ins. So Bitcoin because too big to fail. That's a broad view.
Okay, very good. Yes. Well, Bitcoin is a decentralized peer-to-peer currency for the internet, basically. And people should use it because it is effectively a reaction to centralization. So in the current monetary system, we have all these central authorities, and effectively they have abused their privilege to issue currency, to issue debt, and they exercise increasingly total control over the system. And effectively, Bitcoin is a reaction against this, because Bitcoin allows us to transfer value peer-to-peer, human being to human being, directly, without any intermediaries, parasites, banks, custodians, clearing houses, all these people. We don't need them anymore. Math and cryptography have allowed us to create a currency that is decentralized, where we can transfer value for the first time peer-to-peer, person-to-person. And it's an amazing thing when you begin to conceptualize it. It's an astonishing advance for humanity, and I think it will eventually lead to a new form of monetary system that will restore power over their own affairs to individual human beings, as opposed to the control being exercised by the wider institutional financial framework that we have today.
I think to add to that, just as a practical example, the remittance market as it is today, for example, if looking to do an international transfer, say, family who come to the UK to work and they want to remit funds back to their family, say, like in Pakistan or wherever it may be, at the moment they would need to use Western Union, and Western Union can charge up to, say, 10%. And if you're remitting, say, £200, which is hard-earned cash for a low-income family, back to your family in Pakistan, 10% of that is quite a lot of money. Whereas with Bitcoin, the difference is you pretty much got zero or minimal transaction fees. So it immediately becomes a disruptive business model for the remittance market. Now that's, if you weren't a remittance from the developed to the developing world, but the worst case is from the developing world to the developing world. So they were looking, there was a study in Africa, and they said that money remittance between countries in Africa could cost up to 20% commission. So if you think about it, the integration of Bitcoin in the remittance market is going to completely revolutionize the existing framework, and 10% commission will no longer be acceptable.
Bitcoin is more than just a currency as well. In a way, it's a shame that Bitcoin, the name of this technology, has the word coin in it, because at its core, Bitcoin is a secure asset register for any kind of digital asset. So it just so happens that people are thinking of it as a currency, but those tokens within the Bitcoin protocol could represent anything. They could be shares in Apple, they could be apples, they could be your property, they could be your car. And I think as time goes on, we're going to see more and more applications of the Bitcoin protocol which go beyond a currency.
Cool. So a question I've got from Devon, who I don't think is here, but she says Bitcoin is not backed by any real commodity like gold or a government. So in that sense, how does it have any value compared to other assets in terms of gold and government-issued currencies?
Well, I mean, the dollar's not backed by anything. The dollar's a promise. The dollar's a debt promise. There's nothing at the end of it. If you send someone a dollar at the Federal Reserve, they'll send you a dollar back. The whole thing at its heart is effectively a Ponzi scheme. And basically, you know, it seems to be centered more or less around military power, pretty much. So I don't think that any of the existing fiat currencies today, none of them are backed by anything. They're all pure promises. They are debt creations out of thin air. And effectively, you know, the link with gold was broken in 1971, and they've never gone back to it because it's much more convenient to print loads of money and hand it out to favored groups than it is to have a sound monetary system. So I don't think that, you know, the objection that Bitcoin is not backed by anything is very strong because, you know, none of the existing fiat currencies are backed by anything. And I think Bitcoin is essentially stronger in that no one is forcing you to use Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a voluntary choice. It's a free market choice. You choose to use it if you want to. Its value comes from the network of people who use it. But if you don't choose to use it, no one is putting a gun to your head and saying, you must use this because it's legal tender in the United States or the UK or wherever. So that is the difference with fiat currency. Fiat currency derives its value from legal tender laws which force us to use this currency in the UK or the US or wherever. No one is forcing you to use Bitcoin. Bitcoin is no one's liability. So I think, in essence, Bitcoin has the backing of the human community who choose to use it.
Additionally, Bitcoin is also backed by something that fiat currencies are not, and that's the laws of mathematics. This is something that no fiat currencies really follow. The only rules that fiat currencies follow are whatever decisions the central banks are taking, essentially. Now, when it comes to Bitcoin, everything is set in the code. You can read the code. It's open source. It's transparent. There is no surprises. Tomorrow, you're not going to have a devaluation of Bitcoin because suddenly someone wants to start printing a lot more, you know, issuing a lot more of those tokens. So that's something extra that no fiat currencies do have. Furthermore, you know, going to the gold standards, the big difference between having something like Bitcoin or having a gold standard, something that we must remember, is that in order to get gold, in order to mine gold, for now hundreds of years, there has been a lot of suffering in the sense where many people may have been displaced from wherever they lived in order for the gold mines to be open. There's been a lot of, you know, blood behind the production of gold. Whereas with Bitcoins, there is no need for any of this violence. Everything is using the rules of mathematics and a protocol on the internet. So it's actually even better than something backed by an asset like gold, which, you know, requires violence sometimes to gain.
Also, another point is, we talk about Bitcoin, but also we're looking at the context of cryptocurrencies / digital currencies. So Bitcoin itself is an example of a cryptocurrency. It uses cryptographic mathematics to transmit value, etc., with private and public keys. But you have other types, other variations of cryptocurrencies, which may have a backing system or may not. A digital currency that you may or may not be aware of, it's not particularly successful, is, for example, Venn. Venn is a token, a digital token, that is backed by a basket of different assets. And this concept of, if you weren't backing a digitalized digital token against real assets, is becoming quite catchy concept in the crypto sphere. Partly because it is possible, and as Tom was saying, Bitcoin is essentially a medium of exchange and it could actually represent other things. And so if you have that facility inherent in the Bitcoin network, then you can back it by anything you want, as long as you effectively trust the person who's issuing those tokens. So a popular thing now is this idea of fiat coin. So you take dollars and you put it onto the Bitcoin network, and you say you have a dollar coin, which you can then use the Bitcoin network to remit that value, but then it becomes like a form of electronic money. So there are so many other opportunities. So when we talk about Bitcoin, it's not just Bitcoin. There are a variety of other cryptocurrencies out there in systems that are backed or not necessarily backed by something.
Yes, so as Hakeem said, Bitcoin is backed by this hard-coded limit of 21 million Bitcoins that exist, and that's backed by the mathematics and the cryptography. One byproduct of this is that you can't have any kind of monetary control, no monetary policy in Bitcoin. So there's an open question there about whether you can have a proper functioning currency without that kind of monetary control. I mean, I guess with alternative cryptocurrencies, you could have some kind of monetary control, but can you do that without some kind of human intervention? And are you then, you know, bypassing the whole point of cryptocurrencies? What do you guys think? Mm.
Well, I don't think monetary control is necessary, and essentially monetary control historically benefits the insiders who issue the currency or control the money, because they tend to allocate it to themselves. So I think it's better if there is no control.
What about the volatility aspect of sort of a lot of people, sort of the general thing you hear is, oh, you know, you don't know what the price is going to be compared to, for example, the pound sterling, or suddenly gone down, or...
It depends on your numeraire. I mean, it depends what you're regarding it. If you think in terms of dollars, then there is volatility. But if you think in terms of bitcoins, and if we have a Bitcoin type, you know, economy, then you know it's in bitcoins. So it's just that people come from a mindset of viewing things in terms of the existing fiat currencies. And they can't conceive of moving to a different mindset. Everything can be inverted, effectively. You can say that assets have risen in sterling. You know, you could say house prices have risen in sterling, but you know, 40 years later, it's still the same house. So in house terms, there hasn't been any rise at all. So it really depends on how you look at it.
Additionally, the volatility is a byproduct of the teething issue that you have with a nascent currency like Bitcoin. Essentially, the volatility that we are seeing today is essentially due to the not enough market depth, the amount of people who are buying, the amount of people who are selling. It's not quite in the mainstream, Bitcoin. So at the moment, yes, we have volatility, and that's a normal thing because of the market depth. But as the market depth increases, as more and more people get to start using Bitcoin, buying and selling it, the volatility will reduce. And as we get closer to the theoretical price, or whatever that is, then that's going to reduce as well.
And it's also due to largely the lack of a derivatives market in Bitcoin. In other currencies, you can bet either way on the price. In Bitcoin, you can't really do that on a large scale at the moment. And therefore, that volatility can't be dampened down.
Do you want to add anything?
Well, just to add to Tom's point and Hakeem's point, it is an early stage industry. There isn't a derivatives market, but it's coming. And it exists already. There is a derivatives market, but it's not the same scale that you find in the normal financial services markets. But it's coming. The infrastructure is popping up as we speak. And for that matter, you know, when I speak to people, entrepreneurs, who are thinking, oh, what do I, you know, there's so many exchanges out there. Shall I set up an exchange? I say set one up. The more liquidity, the better. Because, you know, when I was talking earlier about the remittance market and how you can use Bitcoin, that is only possible if you have local liquidity. So the more exchanges that can come up, the better it is for the whole Bitcoin ecosystem, as I see it.
Cool. At this point, I've completely forgot to mention the sponsors who kindly provided the beers, who are Makers Academy, and Yevgeny, who was here earlier, has had to head off. So thanks to them, who do a 12-week web coding course, and they accept Bitcoins for that as well. So I found it quite difficult to approach the usual sponsors I have for these events, but a lot of people were quite kind of I got the sense maybe fearful of wanting to be associated with Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. Makers Academy, again, not at all. They're already using it to trade, accepting people on their courses who pay in Bitcoin. But I guess the question is about the legitimacy, and how do you kind of break through that barrier? I think Fergus Lemon, are you here? Fergus sort of said that UK banks are reluctant to allow their business customers to transact in Bitcoin. Is this true, and are there any banks, how do you get around that, or any banks that are better to deal with in that aspect, and how do you make it more legitimate?
Yes, this is one of the biggest issues we face as a digital currency business, not just with banks, but any kind of large company which is only read about Bitcoin and the Metro and the Gangster, Silk Road and Mt. Gox. It's being able to get past that and explain the technology and what the huge benefits of it are. So talking about banking, basically it's impossible to get a bank account in the UK if you're a Bitcoin business. How do we get around that? Well, I think you have to look at it from the bank's point of view. It's an unregulated industry at the moment. They need to comply with money laundering regulations. When Bitcoin's involved, that's tough for them to do. I think we need to see proper regulation in place, and I think probably the business model the banks use for this needs to change. I mean, maybe we need to think about transaction fees more than paying through holding large amounts in banks.
But this is not an uncommon problem in other regulated industries. I think Bitcoin has, suffered in the UK as a result of the banking industry not supporting it. If we had support from the banking industry, we would be far ahead of anyone else in the world. But this is not uncommon. The other regulated industries are, for example, electronic money and payment services. So we were talking earlier about the remittance market. For those money remittance agents, say for example the Somali corridor, sending money from the UK to your family in Somalia, that their accounts are just shut down. And it all happened in March last year. Barclays, who was the last player in the remittance market, decided to divest themselves of pretty much all of their accounts. And these accounts were held by companies who had licenses from the FCA to operate their business. So the bank is like looking at the business and saying, the FCA has done an audit on you and considers you to be a viable business and that you have sufficient internal controls and that you're not being run by criminals, but I'm still not going to accept your business. It almost becomes, the point is, even if Bitcoin becomes regulated, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get a bank account in the UK. And there's a systemic problem within the UK. And when I spoke directly with the FCA about it, their position is currently, it is still the commercial discretion of the bank whether or not to accept the business. But, trust me, we need to encourage more banks to evolve within the UK, like the German model, have thousands and thousands of banks, and then we can have more specialised business models. Not these huge banks that, have risk models that can change overnight.
But do you actually need a bank account if you're using Bitcoin?
Absolutely. I mean, you're running an exchange, you're going from pounds to pounds to Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. Most businesses will at least have an operational bank account, but there are ways around it. You just need to structure your business accordingly, separate the operations side from if you run the trading side.
Well, I decided to sidestep the banks entirely, which is why I set up an exchange from gold bullion to Bitcoin directly. And effectively, it's completely outside the fiat system, so there is no fiat in bullion Bitcoin at all. And I did this deliberately because I couldn't foresee that the banks would ever be enchanted with the idea of Bitcoin, which effectively is a reaction to sort of their control of the financial system and their monopoly of the financial system. And so, effectively I decided to sidestep it completely, and that's what we have. Bullion Bitcoin, gold to Bitcoin, Bitcoin to gold. So that's how I dealt with it, anyway.
Right, two points. The first one is the smear campaign that's gone on Bitcoin for the last, quite a few years now. Remember, the attention of the media regarding Bitcoin has been concentrated, essentially, in some potential risk that Bitcoin could be used to launder money, finance terrorism, child pornography, and all the negative buzzwords that you can think of. Now, bear in mind that the real point about Bitcoin has nothing to do with all these things, really. The essential value proposition of Bitcoin is you can be empowered to manage your own money, you be your own bank, you'll have your wallets with your Bitcoin, and you're in charge of whoever you want to send them to, whoever you want to send them, whenever you want to send them. So the smear campaign that we've seen is a distraction to keep the people away from the real value proposition of Bitcoin. Unfortunately, the mainstream media for a few years has done this smear campaign, and they've done a good job at it. Sometimes when I speak to people about Bitcoin, I hear people say to me, but isn't Bitcoin illegal? Isn't Bitcoin something to do with money laundering and drugs? You know, totally not aware of what the real value proposition of Bitcoin is. Now, to go back to the banks, as I was saying earlier, you know, in the blockchain, in the very first block, Satoshi Nakamoto did put some texts, and the text is about the bailouts in the UK. It's, you know, a small piece of something in the Times newspaper talking about the bailout. So you see from inception that Bitcoin, the Bitcoin offers to people the ability to make the too big to fail a little bit smaller so they can actually fail. Now, if you think that the banks are in this unique position where if you want to operate in a country, if you want to pay your employees, if you want to pay your taxes, if you want to do anything that normal business do, you need a bank account. If you're not a company, if you're a regular person, here in the UK, I found out that in order to register to a GP, you need to show them a bank, you know, a bank statement with your address on it. So you can't register to a GP without a bank account. Now, bear with me. Imagine for a second that, let's say, digital cameras, people who manufactured digital cameras at the very inception of such products, had to seek finance or the blessing of people who used to produce, like Kodak, the films. What kind of reaction they would have got, right? So now we are in this unique situation where businesses who want to do all kind of different services or products, sometimes, you know, I know that even businesses who manufacture pieces of hardware like point of sales equipment and who don't touch Bitcoin in a sense, they would sell their products for pounds, for example, to shop assistants, to shop owners, sorry. They wouldn't be able to get a bank account here in the UK, even though they're not really having to deal with AML, KYC the same way that an exchange would have to deal with. So bear in mind that the struggle with the banks is embedded in the nature itself of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a decentralized monetary system. The banks are essentially the cornerstones of the central monetary system in which we are currently living.
I just want to add, I mean, it's good to play devil's advocate because we all vote Bitcoin pretty much. So the other side of the story, and this is, if you weren't relating a real life interview that I had with a big financial institution that wanted to enter into Bitcoin, and I was speaking with the money laundering reporting officer, and we sat down in this meeting, and he said to me, well, you know, I don't really want to put myself in a position where I'm receiving Bitcoin because I have no idea where those Bitcoins have come from. Now, strictly speaking, you can look up the blockchain and see where those Bitcoins have come from, although there are certain mixing things that make it almost impossible. So if you weren't, from a risk management perspective, Bitcoin from a financial institution's perspective is similar to cash. And if you're receiving cash, you wouldn't receive £10,000 worth of cash without doing full KYC, knowing exactly where that money has come from and the whole story behind it. And that's what I said to him pragmatically, that effectively, you need to deal with it as cash. Therefore, you need to place the onus on your customers to provide you with the information that they need to provide in order to satisfy yourself of the risk of that transaction. But it doesn't mean that you just turn a blind eye or that you don't go for the business. You go for the business, but realize the business you're entering into, i.e. you go full eyes open, you require information on it, and gradually, as the regulations start to come in that are specific for Bitcoin, then there'll be a clearer guidance. So I think there is still room for the financial services industry to enter into this market, but it will involve enhanced due diligence on customers, and that's basically it.
Keep in mind that, you know, for a bank to accept a Bitcoin business, they don't need to accept Bitcoin themselves.
Correct, but this is any kind of financial institution that wants to interface with the Bitcoin network needs to, in my opinion, conduct enhanced due diligence on their customers because of the nature of the very fact that, look, let me explain this to you. If you have a Forex company, an online Forex company, and you deposit onto that online Forex company, it's not face-to-face relationship. So the AML laws in this country requires the Forex company to receive the first deposit from that customer from their bank account and to do the reconciliation on their side. If I'm the customer and I'm depositing in Bitcoin, that does not equate to a bank account, so they can't do that enhanced due diligence on the customer. So what alternative solution do they have in that scenario? They don't, therefore they need to conduct further enhanced due diligence on the customer to satisfy themselves. Unless that customer also has a bank account. If they have a bank account, then they can deposit using that. But it's also about thinking about pragmatic solutions that will encourage financial institutions to take on board this risk.
I've got some pragmatic solutions for the problem of money laundering and anti-terror financing. How about we make sure that there are no terrorists by just not creating terrorists? That would be a great start. And then regarding money laundering, you know, people who deal in the dark world, essentially, if they had the opportunity, a lot of people go into the black market because they don't necessarily have the opportunity to participate in a regular work. You know, a lot of people are unemployed and they have to get some form of living. If the society was a bit more fair, would we have the same problems with money laundering and drugs and all these things? That's just a question, right?
Yeah.
That's a whole different topic.
Yeah. It is.
Yeah. Maybe this is what...
Just putting things in perspective.
From Hugh over there.
So, suppose you've done enhanced due diligence on me. You know my bank account, you know my where I live, you know my full family history, whatever it is. How does that tell you if I'm dealing drugs, money laundering, dealing weapons, I'm a terrorist?
Okay, so knowing customer identity, you know, that's, if you weren't, the first hurdle, and a very easy one to accomplish. Let's say someone deposits with you 50 pence, and then in 3 months' time deposits 10,000, and then 100,000. Here you have a change in the financial profile. And if I was running a CFD online forex company, at that moment, you know, alarm bells will ring. And so what enhanced due diligence will I conduct? Well, AML laws are based on a risk assessment basis. So it's for you to employ your own discretion through your money laundering reporting officer to identify what checks you need to do. It's not prescriptive, the laws. You need to actually use your own discretion to find out where those funds have come from, and that's the point. It's source of funds. So you push the onus back onto the customer to say, well, where do you get the money from?
There's a question at the back as well. Yeah,
Rob.
I have lots of questions, but I'm going to try and stay focused. My first point to those in the room who are concerned about the other side, about what you were talking about in relation to regulation and how central banks fail all the time. A great book to read is When Money Dies by Adam Ferguson, who wrote on the Weimar Republic and the collapse of money there. That is genius. You should read that. But my question, I was going to think about something bigger, but my question is very simple. I want to invest £50 in Bitcoin now. How do I do it?
There's loads of places where you can do that.
Yeah, so let's sort of go back to wind down a bit, go to the practicalities.
So you've got people who are dealers, so traders who are willing to do face-to-face exchanges. Then, like Joe was saying, you've got as well ATMs now available where you can go with £50 in the ATM, put it in the ATM, and then get the bitcoins on your phone. You know, you've got companies like CryptoPay now. Come again?
There's an app.
There's wallets for your phone, yeah.
Bitcoin wallet for Android.
This the card, yeah?
Right, this is a wallet card right there.
Cold storage?
Cold storage, yeah.
Which is just like having them off the internet or in a card which you can bury in the garden or put in under the mattress. So, hacking someone else, we're just like go right back to the beginning, someone who knows nothing about Bitcoin. How do you just go out? Who do you need to speak to? Obviously, you can't, I don't think, mine them unless you want to spend God knows how much.
So easy, right?
What, Bitcoin?
To get started
on
Bitcoin. Exactly. Go
to Bitcoin.org, watch the video.
There's loads of wallets that you can download, whether it's on your phone, on your computer. You can download, you know, paper wallets. You can download all kinds of different wallets. There are apps for the Android. Apple took off all the apps regarding Bitcoin for their own commercial reasons. They may let them come back.
They are backed.
Oh, they are backed? Yeah. All of them?
After the speeches, by the way, anyone who hasn't got Bitcoin will set us up with an app. We'll give you $1 for free. Get you started.
Woo!
Hey, Hugh!
There you go.
The man.
Thousands of pounds tomorrow.
So it's really easy to participate. Okay. To participate is so easy. You download the software. You download software or an app, and you've got your wallet, and now you can start receiving and sending bitcoins. That's
and,
it.
And how
so
does the whole, there's sort of two codes or two rows of numerical figures or?
Oh, wallets are made up of public and private key pairs. So with a private key, there is a public key. I don't know how familiar you are, guys, with cryptography.
No.
No? Okay. So. You've got an address, like an email address, that's your public key. That's what you give to people when you want to receive bitcoins. They can send the money to you. And your private key essentially is something that you want to keep very safe, because that's your ability to sign away your ownership of bitcoins to another person, i.e. send the bitcoins to a third party. Essentially, that's what it is.
So you don't want to get the public and the private keys mixed up?
You can't. Usually all the wallets conceal from you the private key unless you specifically go and find it. They don't give you access to this information so easily. They show you very easily all your addresses to receive bitcoins, but not so easily the private keys.
Okay, cool. Next question. I was reading earlier about how something called M-Pesa, which isn't a cryptocurrency as such, but it's a mobile app in Kenya that they use. And apparently 43% of GDP now goes through people sending money through this mobile app. So it's like massively well used by the population. But generally around the world, most people don't have access to the banking system and all the rest of it. But how even now, where we've got a UK where everyone has a mobile phone and all the rest of it, what's stopping us? Or rather, what do people need to do to sort of drive the mass adoption of people starting to use Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies? I don't know why M-Pesa took off so well in Kenya, whether there's any lessons to be learned from that.
Well, M-Pesa is essentially an SMS-based service, so it's not even an app, because remember, not everyone over there in Kenya can afford a high-end mobile phone, so SMS-based, and essentially it enables people to send and receive the local currency in the form of digital tokens. So M-Pesa is a company that's essentially reconciliates the accounts of all their members. So you can upload money, you go to a shop, give them some local currency, and then they upload some of that minus the fees, which are quite high, by the way, onto your wallet. And then you can send an SMS to whoever you want with some money. So that has taken off in Kenya, because you must know that in places in Africa, you don't find a bank in every street corner. You don't have access to banking in the same way that you have access to banking in Europe. So for people over there, it is so easy and convenient to start participating in exchanging value with an SMS. And that value can be exchanged for all kinds of different purposes. And that's why it's taken off, because people out there don't necessarily have a bank account. Banks are sometimes very far off from where they live. They don't want to walk miles to go to the bank. It's so convenient and easy to go to a local agent and get some credits on your mobile phone and use it, even though the charges are very high. Now, as far as Bitcoin is concerned, we are in a different paradigm here. We have banks on street corners. We have online banking. It's kind of okay, not so difficult for people in the UK to gain access to a bank account. So it's not the same need. And of course, Bitcoin is a separate currency on top of that. So for people to start using it, they need to understand what it is at first.
Just in terms of lessons learned, I think one of the maybe challenges that Bitcoin faces at the moment is that its reliance on the internet. So M-Pesa, as Hakeem was saying, is via text messages. Whereas Bitcoin, inherently, if you're using wallets, etc., you need to have access to the internet. Not necessarily to do transactions off-chain, but if you're just using it in a natural situation, you really need to have access to the internet. And the reason, is it would be difficult to challenge M-Pesa in Kenya is because mobile internet isn't as widespread. However, that said, there are some interesting innovations within Bitcoin in terms of hardware wallets that use radio communications to transmit Bitcoins, or Bluetooth to transmit Bitcoins. Again, these are off-chain transactions which are reconciled when you have access to the internet. So I think Bitcoin at the moment, in terms of innovations, have managed to overcome the challenge of being so dependent on the internet.
Cool. Take the question from the gentleman, white collar chef.
Which I think conceptually is everyone can understand that you only pay, you have to pay Western Union 12%. When you actually drill down into the numbers, it's actually economically, they don't stack up actually. To send Bitcoin to Kenya now, it's much, much cheaper to use Western Union because the fiat Bitcoin conversion is so inefficient that they're much better off using Western Union. So my question to you is, how are we going to make it easier for the Kenyan population in London? I'm simply referring to a business called BitPesa, which they established a means of doing this, but it is that cheap. Now I think liquidity is a big part to play in that. My second question, if you'll bear with me, is that I think I read the other day that 63% of all Bitcoins in circulation are held in inactive wallets or. So how are we going to get away from this Bitcoin is a speculative asset to actually using the utility of the technology, which is so important for financial inclusion?
Yeah, I mean, on the second...
Go, Tom, in a minute.
On the second point, I'm sure these guys can answer that. But on the first point, I'd like to state that actually I wrote an article on the remittance market and comparing it, the Western Union model with the Bitcoin model. In the end, today, it was cheaper to use the normal remittance channels. But that is today. Tomorrow, Western Union will need to adapt to survive because the more liquidity, local liquidity, means you can have better spreads. I can exchange my Kenyan shillings for Bitcoin at a very competitive price. Now I have to go onto local bitcoins, and I might not even get Kenyan shillings. I'll get the conversion maybe for US dollars, and I have to convert back, and it becomes messy. But the future is not Western Union. The future is Bitcoin for remittance, and that will be inevitable. The more exchanges, local exchanges, that pop up, the more infrastructure liquidity that's there, the cheaper it will be to send money. Now I must admit that it's very difficult to explain to a family, don't go to Western Union and put your cash there that you just earned. No, learn about Bitcoin and cryptography and send that to your family. There's an awareness campaign which is probably as challenging as generating local liquidity, but it will happen. It's the inevitable. People who are building businesses along the Western Union lines, not really future-proofing their business.
Yeah,
and the future is the person in Kenya at the other end doesn't have to convert back for local currency. They can use those bitcoins to pay for goods and services at the other end.
Yes.
And this is where the long-term mainstream uptake of Bitcoin is dependent on being able to use it as a payment mechanism. At the moment, even if I have bitcoins, I mean, why should I use it to pay for my coffee down the road? I mean, it's a hassle. It takes a bit longer to use my credit card. There needs to be a strong user proposition for using it. And it is there. It should be cheaper. It should be much cheaper than using a credit card where they take 3% of every transaction from the retailer. But at the moment, retailers aren't passing that cost saving on to the consumer. I think the future is having a range of options for your payments and each one being a different cost to the consumer. If you pay with Bitcoin, it's £2. If you pay with a debit card, it's £2.20. If you pay with a credit card, it's £2.50. And I think that would be a real reason for mainstream uptake of Bitcoin.
Just in terms of remittance, how about TransferWise? Because you mentioned those Western Union, which have extension fees, but TransferWise has seemingly overcome these. How does this compare with Bitcoin's fees?
I'm not saying that there's no room for remittance for innovation in the remittance market per se. I'm just saying that you have a piece of infrastructure here which is extremely cheap. And I don't really foresee a scenario within 10 years, assuming that infrastructure still remains, the blockchain, mining,
that people will still be building models using the banking system for remittances. It just doesn't make any sense.
Yes, aside from Bitcoin, I would like to ask each member of the panel, what is the most commercially compelling application of blockchain technology that you have come across?
Well, so from a colour coins point of view, the idea of representing financial securities using Bitcoin tokens and therefore enabling secure, verifiable transfer of ownership of those securities between people without having to use the traditional exchange, clearing, settlement infrastructure. I think there's a real opportunity there.
Well, I mean, I think what we have is what we're discussing now is Bitcoin 2.0, which is effectively protocols like Ethereum and Mastercoin and Counterparty. Tom just discussed colored coins, which is another sort of version of that. And these are things which are using the concept of the blockchain, which is a distributed public ledger, in order to transfer value and assets, as Tom mentioned earlier. And Ethereum is the sort of big and sort of exciting project that is out there. Ethereum is proposing to allow us to have decentralized autonomous organizations, so effectively companies registered on the blockchain. So taking the registration of companies away from a physical geographical jurisdiction and moving it onto the blockchain, where the rights between contracting parties and shareholders are all on the blockchain. We also have effectively the ability to, will have with Ethereum, the ability to code smart contracts. So effectively people will be able to...
What about the Companies Act 2006?
What about it?
I don't know why. Surely there needs to be a body of law if you're going to...
Well, there will be a body of law effectively on the blockchain, but effectively
code,
it means it's in the code. Relations between human beings are governed by the code, not by central authorities. So it takes it beyond currency, beyond the transfer of value, to it being a place where people can contract and have decentralized autonomous organizations on the blockchain, contracts on the blockchain, securities on the blockchain, bonds on the blockchain. And so it goes. It effectively makes it borderless and totally personal, totally peer-to-peer across the whole of humanity, which is very, very exciting.
What if the dispute arises? Who is to resolve it if you don't have a central authority?
The code.
The code.
No.
The code.
The contracts are not legally binding, not contracts. There's a great video that was posted a week ago on the legality of what they call Ethereum contracts, and not their agents representing. There's three parts to a legal contract called under law. The one fulfills two. The third one is not there. So
what's the third one?
It's considerations. So if I give you
$100,000
for a pad of paper, that's not a consideration. I pay something back for my $100,000. So it only registers who's buying and who's selling, but the third bit's not necessary.
No, but the consideration can be in the code because the consideration can be Bitcoin. You could say, if this happens, then Bitcoin will be delivered at X date, effectively. So
well, watch the video. It's an hour long by a patent lawyer in the States. It makes it very good.
Well, I mean, a US lawyer is hardly likely to be in favor of something that effectively means that the law, all this US law, is no longer really necessary. And, you know, all this stuff, we don't need phalanxes, lawyers, really, to contract between human beings. This is something that's created by a central authority and effectively has been imposed upon us and is a highly expensive system, in my view.
There's no way to make a contract explicit so that the exchange actually happens. So if the exchange doesn't happen, say you're registered using blockchain and Ethereum to pass a piece of physical property, there's nothing that necessarily forces someone to fulfill that contract and you go to the
you can assign a third party as an escrow.
Yes. In fact, we are developing an escrow service in Bullion Bitcoin at the moment.
Before we move to the next questions, just to go back to the question that was asked earlier, you were asking about commercial ventures, right?
Yes.
But I wanted to talk about something a little more exciting as well, and it touches the subject of laws. You could use blockchain technology to run voting systems as well. Imagine that your democratic system would allow everyone to vote on the laws of the nation instead of voting for an MP and then hoping that your MP is going to represent you adequately. You could see the creation of new voting system where the parliament is taken online and every person from the nation, every voter, has access to a wallet or more a way to actually vote on a blockchain. And you know, the beauty of a blockchain vote means that it becomes extremely difficult to hijack the vote the same way that the Diebold voting machines in America were hijacked during the elections over the last few years. So this is an exciting development as well. It's not commercial, but it has great potential for democracy.
Jeff, front row.
Yes, so you're presenting the Bitcoin like a worldwide currency, so worldwide exchange and everything. But basically the euro as well was trying to create not a worldwide, but at least a European currency. I forget the central bank banking and fiat currency side, but now everyone, especially the English, are doubting about the possibility of a European currency, and it's going to blow up, it's not possible. So how do you see it? Do you see a combination of several cryptocurrency, which is the title of today, in terms of laws in parallel, or you see a bigger euro succeeding?
All right. This is a very good question, actually. Now, the way that the euro was implemented was foolish, as far as I am concerned. The euro should have been implemented as a complementary currency, whereby all the national currency would have survived, and would have had the euro living side by side with them. So if you had to do some payments across borders, you could have used the euro. The fact that they totally replaced the national currencies by this one currency was a silly decision, really. Now, as far as Bitcoin is concerned, yes, diversity is key. We want to see as many currencies as possible and let the market essentially decide which one are worth working with or not. That's where I would like to see diversity, diversity, diversity. Not, again, replacing the existing model by just one currency, which would be Bitcoin. That would be a silly move.
I mean, the euro is basically a response created to the abuse of the US dollar as a reserve currency, and that's the reason for creating the euro and the euro area, so that they were not forced to take loads of printed dollars that were sent out to them all the time, so you create your own area, effectively. And there's fairly good argument for that. The weakness, I think, as Hakim alluded to, is that it's not an optimal currency area, the Eurozone, so it should have been originally a smaller, more focused area. But to be frank with you, the euro is still effectively a fiat currency. It still has a central authority. Now, you know, lunacy of lunacies, we have negative interest rates, you know, utter madness. You know, we've basically jumped the shark and gone mad. We have negative interest rates.
That's ridiculous.
We are getting, it is going effectively mad, and it says a lot about the madness of the fiat currency world that we are now at this stage. And Bitcoin is effectively a reaction against the entire system, the euro, the dollar, the central banks, Draghi, all this stuff. We don't want it. We are creating a new system.
It's a solution to a problem.
It's a solution to a problem.
And just want to add a comment here. I mean, you talk about a compelling commercial business case. There are many. And every day you discover a new one. And I think really, you know, when we're talking about Ethereum and whether it's legally binding, all of these questions, essentially that determine fundamentally its adoption, whether it's going to go mass adoption or not. Because if it's not legally binding, then you know what's going to create an inconsistency across the board. So my view is the innovations need to continue, but there needs to be some clarity with regards to what are the legal obligations that apply, what regulations should apply, etc., so that the innovations can continue and we can integrate these technologies into our day-to-day lives. One interesting observation, for example, a compelling business case, was I was speaking with a person about the role of a notary. The notary in society is almost, it's almost expiring, because, you know, 200 years ago, whenever you wanted to sell a house or do anything, you had to go to the notary and they would stamp the documents, etc., and their livelihood depended on the system. And that system effectively is that if you want to send documents to the bank trusts the notary but doesn't trust you. So the relationship of trust through the notary allows the bank to accept your document. So an interesting discussion I had was kind of around this master coin, color coin idea, whereby you have notaries on the blockchain, i.e. these agents, so to speak, you go to them with your passport, etc., and they verify your identity, and you tell them your Bitcoin address, and then they send to you, to your Bitcoin address, a notary coin, for example. And that, if you want, is the validation of your identity. So that when you go to the bank, you show to the bank your Bitcoin address that has the notary coin in it. And then you don't need to send them any documents by mail, etc. Their bank will be reassured that you've been verified by an independent, trustworthy third party. So there's some really interesting, and let's say, you know, not so much in the financial services industry, but just in traditional industries, which are dying, such as notaries, and opportunities for changes. But the key point is about clarity in regards to law and regulations, but innovation should never stop in that respect.
We'd better go to Rob, set his hand up for a while.
Okay, I'm going to ask my big question now. You seem to have been dancing around the topic. You've talked about, you know, the threat that Bitcoin has or poses to the financial system and banks and money and this and the other. But fundamentally, Bitcoin poses an even greater threat to the power of the state. And if we look at a single topic, money laundering, okay? So you talk about money laundering. The process of money laundering is hiding your money from the state. That's what it is. You're hiding your money from the state so that you can pretend it's religious and it's also coming back or whatever. Now, the problem here isn't that it allows criminals to launder money. The problem that, or the great threat from Bitcoin is it allows everybody in this room to launder their money so the state can't get their hands on it. Do you agree?
Yes, to a certain extent I do agree. But, you know, as someone from a libertarian background, I don't think that it's a bad thing. And I have to say that the way in which the system has started to operate creates greater and greater burdens of taxation on the younger generation particularly, and sort of upstreams benefits in this country to the older generation. And it seems to me a system that is rife with unfairness and with subsidies. And I think it's a system that could well do with being cut down to size a bit. So, you know, yes, to some extent you're right. The promise of Bitcoin is that it returns power to the individual, and it's a way of the individual exercising that power against an overweening state. We now have a situation where the US has implemented something called FATCA, right, which is Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, right? And now they're going to implement GATCA. GATCA is the Global Foreign Tax Compliance Act, and that means that every single bank account in every single one of 32 countries is all going to go to a great big server farm, and they're going to see every single transaction done by every single citizen, and they're going to run through it and share it all amongst the 32 countries in the OECD or whatever it is. And that is a definite plan. Now, you know, if you're a statist, you may say, oh, there's nothing wrong with that. But frankly, if you have any feeling towards privacy, individuality, personal freedom, I think you regard it as something that is very concerning. So I think it would be welcome to reduce the power of the state a little bit.
As Adam said, Bitcoin should be thought of like cash. I mean, you can do all those things with cash. Just because you can do those things doesn't mean everyone in the country is going to do it. They want to deal with regulated financial institutions and large companies who are doing these AML checks. So just because you have this ability with Bitcoin, I don't think it means that it may be more widespread.
No, I wasn't saying that's not what I said.
Okay, sorry, what did you say?
Well, I said it was a threat, a potential.
Sure, I don't think it's really much more threat than physical cash, though. In fact, it's probably less threat because you have every transaction recorded on the blockchain.
So as you gain cash, then?
But there is a war on cash. I mean,
there's a war on cash.
There is a war on cash. I mean, I don't know if you've noticed that, but cash is this dirty thing that we are supposed not to be using at the moment. You know, it's gone onto the Oyster card. Soon, your Oyster card, you'll be able to go to WH Smith and buy a newspaper with it if you can't already do it. And you've got all the, you know, the touch and pay cards. You know, well, the trend that we're going to is cash is dirty. We don't want it. Well, we. They don't want it, therefore they want to be able to have all the transactions recorded digitally. Now, the big question though is, why are the governments so concerned with people, you know, hiding their money from them? It's essentially because they want tax money, right? Now, the question that I have for government is, where is the money that we've already paid? How come we are supposed, us, citizens, to be totally transparent, to do everything completely transparently as far as they're concerned? We need to show them all the transactions that we do all the time, etc., etc. But we can't have the same transparency from our elected representatives. That's like, hang on a minute. And I don't know if you remember this little incident that took place on the 10th of September 2001. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? 10th of September 2001, Rumsfeld. $2 trillion missing from the budget in the Pentagon. $2 trillion missing. Where is the money? And of course, now they're trying to get all the money they can and trying to make us feel that we are all gangsters and terrorists because we want to use something like Bitcoin, but it's not true. Let's see a bit more transparency from them as well. Let's demand this transparency from them as well, the same way that they demand it from us.
I just want to add, sorry, just to balance the panel, that, you know, I mean, we always have this debate with these guys. So, you know, you can go at it and look at Bitcoin as a libertarian political tool, or you could just admire its technological benefits for society. Personally, if you say that using Bitcoin is a way of avoiding tax, then I would disagree. I would say there's no difference between you having Bitcoin or you having cash in the bank. Yes, you have a record in the bank, and the bank can disclose that record to HMRC. But Bitcoin, on my tax return, there will be Bitcoin statements. On my company's return, there will be Bitcoin statements. It's no difference. I'm holding cash, I'm holding assets, I'm holding this. I declare it as part of my return. So it's whether you comply with tax laws or whether you don't. It's not a question of whether you use Bitcoin and therefore you don't comply, or whether you don't use Bitcoin and you do comply. That's ridiculous.
Except the banks confiscate cash.
You can say that in terms of, oh yeah, and also HMRC can dip into your account now. So, well, not now, but they're foreseeing that they will. But I think the important, really important point is that it's not, Bitcoin isn't a way of avoiding tax. People may use it for that purpose. But I certainly don't, and many others don't.
But also, so, you have inflation as another second form of effective tax, so quantitative easing, or have you?
Is with the people, surely with Bitcoin or cryptocurrency, is that not possible?
Well, I mean, you're insulated from inflation as a form of quantitative easing. But I think Hakeem's point is really fundamental. These are alternative monetary systems, okay? You know, if the euro...
Complementary.
Alternative bodies, they run in parallel, and we're not trying to... I'm not advocating that we replace Bitcoin with US dollars and things like that, but they just all run in parallel, and, you know, it's healthy competition, and see which one wins.
Actually, to add on what Adam was saying, please beware, don't think that because you use Bitcoin, you're going to be able to do the things like, you know, hide money away from the taxman. Because please remember what Snowden told us, right? He told us that your emails are being watched and all your communication, your online communication are being watched. So bear in mind that if you communicate your Bitcoin wallet through an email to someone, that information is now known by the state. So now they can look on the blockchain and find out all the transactions that you've made on your Bitcoin wallet. So don't think that because you're using Bitcoin, you're going to be away from, you know, the
so it's all just been set up by the NSA.
So
we'll go to the chap in the suit in the middle, yeah.
I think we're missing one of the most interesting topics, in my opinion. It's all good to talk about the advantages, disadvantages, what you can and shouldn't do with bitcoins and other cryptocurrencies, but this is at the moment a niche product. This is something that only a few people understand. And the majority of people have even heard of it, and those who have, probably most of them don't even understand it. So the point is, this is a niche product. How do you convert it into something that people use? Because that's when it becomes actually powerful. That's when people will be starting to use it. How do you make it, how do you make a normal person, somebody on the street, somebody in the park, somebody in the supermarket, understand what Bitcoin is, but, and give them the opportunity to use it?
You know what's great, actually, regarding this point, is that the people who are going to get the mainstream to start looking into Bitcoins are actually the banks. And what I mean by that is what I was talking earlier about in Austria. When you start to see bail-ins in Austria, I mean, we saw them in Cyprus. People thought, oh, you know, it's Cyprus, doesn't matter. Now we're seeing them in Austria. Who knows next? Is it going to be Ireland? Is it going to be Italy? Is it going to be England? Now, when people start to realize that, you know, regarding the bail-ins, remember, let me tell you this little detail about the European Central Bank. The European Central Bank put together a directive regarding the bail-ins. Now, in this directive, they use very interesting vocabulary. They justify bail-ins by saying that the bank customers need to exert market disciplines when choosing who to bank with. That's what the European Central Bank has told all of you. You guys need to exert market discipline when you choose who to bank with. Now, with counterparty risks between banks, does it really matter who you're banking with? If this bank X collapses, who knows whether the other or some other banks will suffer the consequences of that? And when more than one bank has to bail in, i.e. take money from your bank account in order to cover their losses, then people are going to start to understand that exerting market discipline can include diversifying the ways that you store your wealth, i.e. buying gold, buying bitcoins, buying other type of assets that mean that you don't give that money to the bank and therefore you are exerting market discipline.
Yeah, I agree with Hakim. Basically, a crisis drives mass adoption, in my view. Yeah. And the next time there is a major financial crisis that makes 2008 look like a walk in the park, there will be more adoption because, as Hakim says, banks may, probably will close, have to close because the state will not be able to take their balance sheet onto itself because it did that last time.
That's
and
it.
It's still carrying it, so they can't do that again. So basically they're going to have tougher choices next time. And when people find that credit cards are shut down and bank accounts are shut down, then they will see the use of Bitcoin, a decentralized peer-to-peer internet currency that is not controlled by the state or the banks. That, I believe, will really drive mass adoption.
I agree, but it makes it more interesting to use. People won't understand it. I mean, there's no difference from now, say, to 5 years' time.
They'll understand it when they want to transfer value, when they want to trade with each other, when they want to buy things.
Surely where there have been bigger economic crises, I don't know, somebody mentioned Argentina or places where there have been a lot more bigger adoption of Bitcoin, and Cyprus as well, when all the ATMs came in when a couple of years ago.
Or inflation.
Hmm? Yeah.
Inflation. Hyperinflation, even worse.
So we better wrap up. I don't, anyone's got a final question?
Just to add, people probably actually don't need to understand how the Bitcoin
system yes.
works.
Or even the way that emails work.
Yeah, you don't need to understand TCP/IP to
use it. If you give it to consumers in a consumable form, they won't know that they'll know it's running on the Bitcoin rail on top of the blockchain, but they don't need to really understand how the technology works, I don't think.
Yeah, I think that's fundamental. Like wallets, three years ago, were pretty obscure things in terms of interfaces, etc. But wallets now, you know, such as Hive, etc., and they're much more user friendly. But the only thing that I would say that the consumer needs to focus on is that they are actually taking responsibility for their money. So if they use their private key, that's it. I'm sorry, done. Unless you hold it with Elliptic, in which they're insured. But the point is, the infrastructure is there. There will be options, more options. But fundamentally, it's about taking responsibility, and that takes time, it takes a generation, you know. And same with the internet, you know, like my parents don't didn't really adopt the internet when it came to, when it blew up. But myself did, because I was of the younger generation. So I think it's a generational gap as well.
Last question, gentleman blue shirt.
Can I ask everyone? I was listening to one of these questions actually regarding the speculation and how you fight against it. Actually, you didn't have the response to that. And I thought that is related to the same subject. Is you're talking about bitcoins protecting the value of something against inflation and things like that. But on the other side, you see the price of bitcoin is going up and down constantly, and in huge rates.
I think it's probably Tom's turn, isn't it?
Yeah.
I would say, some people say holding, other people say saving, some people say speculation, other people say investments. You know, bear in mind that if you had bought some bitcoins, a year ago, the current market fluctuation, the current volatility would not even concern you whatsoever. If you bought them at $30, say, and now you've got a fluctuation in price of $30 a day, you're still laughing, you're not going to be worrying too much about it. So what we've seen in the past is various jumps in price. So right now, we reached in November the $1,000 price, we saw a retracement. That's a totally normal and healthy thing to see in a price movement. And the price is starting to gather momentum again. Now, I don't know when the next jump is going to be, but people who invested at $1,000, when the price will be gravitating around, say, $5,000, if the price fluctuates by $100 or $200 a day, they're still going to be laughing and they won't be worried about it so much. Now, how this whole holding is going to come to an end, to come back to both questions, I think that essentially once we see more people receiving some part of their wages, or all of their wages, or part of their wages, or bonuses, or whatever they're earning in Bitcoin, people who start selling products or their services in Bitcoin, you will have a natural flow of Bitcoin that is not just for the purpose of speculation. It will be a traditional flow of money where the people who employ their employees pay them some of it in Bitcoin, and then those guys can then use those Bitcoins to start buying things or whatever they want to do with it. So this is, again, a teething issue from a very young system. As we progress, as more people start to understand how it is, and as we see a very rich, diverse ecosystem with people who get paid in Bitcoin, and I know that in the IT community, a lot of people don't mind or actually would rather get some of their money in Bitcoin rather than just in hard currency.